Hey, it's Deep Focus. I'm your host, Mitch Goldman. It's May 8th, 2023. Got a tremendous musician in the house with us tonight, Mark Whitfield. And if you're a regular listener to this music, and especially if you like guitar and you like Wes Montgomery, you probably know all about Mark Whitfield. And if you don't, my goodness, you definitely ought to, you want to find Mark Whitfield's music and add it to your collection. Take the opportunity to see him when he comes through your town, because you'll hear. This is the pleasure in our voices that you're hearing is absolutely genuine. And terrific musician too. I'm so grateful. All the musicians who come through, I really appreciate it. And right now, I'm digging on Mark. Here is part three. If you haven't heard parts one and two, go check them out first. And otherwise, here we go.
In all genres, just the ability to just get a groove, find it quickly, and hold it and keep it hot. Like the energy it takes. In some ways, it's a lot easier to get energized into playing something new. But when you're coming around the next chorus, of course, it helps you backing up Wes because he's feeding you, right? But like you said, this is the perfect setting because two guys cut from the same cloth, the same way, you know. And I relish those moments when we're just like, woo, we get, and it was hot, you know. We keep it going. You don't want to let it go.
How about the imagination that where these he. He plays a little theme. He turns it inside out. He comes back at it again with a different
and not to cut you off, right? The thing is, that's why when we talk about people, it's human nature, right? In a lot of ways, we need comparisons to give ourselves perspective. Like, how does this one compare to that one? Who's better? You know, and my default answer or mindset in that way is that. You always defer to the person who played it first. So it is, you know, you're like, well, this one, you know, he played years later, but he was influenced by what was already played, you know. And so, but you're listening at Wes, at Wes play these things, and you have to be, you know, you got to listen to people. You got to be aware, like a hefty amount of what he's playing had never been played before on the instrument that way. At all, like these octave passages and interspersed with chord, you know, and kind of call and response with himself. That's something that before him just didn't happen. It wasn't like there was this dude, you know, Texas Slim, who played on Thursday nights at the club, you know, at the Elmo Combo, you know, and that's how he. No, man, you listen to a master creating in real time, innovating a style, and then taking that style. Beyond, so it never became a gimmick. It never became a cliche. He never became a caricature of himself. You know, so many guys. In fact, that's something that Ron Carter talked about. He said, you know, right after Wes died, he was in the studio with George, and Creed Taylor brought in George Benson, yeah. And Creed Taylor brought in an octaver. And he's like an octave device. He's like, hey, George, plug this in, which is. And Ron was like, hey, there you go, you know.
In a box.
Yeah, well, exactly, you know, because Creed signed George to A&M to replace Wes. So Creed's first instinct was rather than just, let's see what kind of magic George Benson has. Clearly, he was going to have plenty. But his first instinct was, let's find somebody who can play like Wes, and I'll just put him in a box and hit the button and make octaves out of it, you know. So... Playing with octaves kind of became a cliched caricature for guitar players. You know, it got more and more homogenized over time. And so I just want to point out that this is evidence clearly that if Wes was still playing, he would still be finding new cool stuff to do with octaves that nobody else could do with him. Like it was not. A thing, it was just a thing, if that makes any sense, right?
No, it does. And there's always a little bit of a tension between, like, okay, I know how to do this cool thing. The crowd always loves it. I'm going to throw that in. And, you know, the mind wanders and you're doing these things your fingers know how to do. He never feels like he's doing
that. Yeah, I'm like, please point out which thing that was.
Yeah.
I'll give me any 10-minute Wes solo and please point out the thing he did that was the one thing he thought the crowd was going to, because everything was great. And he didn't stick, you know, nothing had that sort of non-musical filler space value.
He feels so present and attentive and in the moment.
Yeah, he romanced every note and every beat and every phrase and Oren Kepnes says that, you know, there was some things, you know, there's some things that they didn't release, including that thing I referenced earlier, that recording of The Way You Look Tonight, because Wes was such a perfectionist, he just didn't like what they recorded, so, you know, eventually it came out. And I think it's deeper than that. You know, I don't think it's about, I think that's a hard, that's a difficult way to quantify. You know, Wes is playing, and for all intents and purposes, none of our music is quantifiable that way. It's what's good, and what's good enough for us to want to share as musicians and artists is when we hear something that represents us getting to that place where the space is creative and it feels inspired. You know, you get goosebumps listening to it when you played it. You know, you're like, yeah, that's the thing I want people. Yeah, I want that. You know, it's not about how flashy it was or how impressive it was. It's about the emotional chord that it strikes when you hear it. You know, and like you said, it just sounds like Wes was dialed into that 100% of the time, and that's the highest of bars.
Yeah, dude, so true. Mark Whitfield, my guest on Deep Focus. We are all in.
Deep Focus, that's it for Wes.
That's it. This is his show, man. And I wanted to ask you, we were talking about following you at Mark Whitfield, the guitarist.
Oh, sure.
And any shows coming up? People are going to have a chance to hear you play.
Absolutely. Please come out this Thursday night. I do a residency, a once-a-month residency at a place called the Django in the basement of the Roxy Hotel in Tribeca. I'll be there from 10:30 p.m. to 1 a.m. this Thursday night. And I am, you know, every once in a while, I do what I call a young musician showcase, right? And so there are all these, you know, thanks thanks, you know, thanks to being a jazz dad, right? I know so many brilliant young musicians thanks to being around my kids. And one of my favorite young bass players is a young man named Russell Hall. So Russell's got a record out that he calls Black Caesar, and a lot of us played on it. And so we did a thing for him, the Winter Jazz Fest, where we played his music, myself and Stacy Dillard and Timothy Angulo. And Stacy can't be with us, this saxophone player. But Gifton Jelen is someone who I had Gifton he was in the Betty Carter Jazz Ahead class that I was teaching with Jason Moran a few years ago, and now Gifton is just all over the place. So we'll have Gifton Jelen on trumpet, and Timothy Angulo on drums, and Russell Hall on bass, and myself on guitar. It's gonna be a pretty wild show Thursday night at the Django. So come out and be present and have some fun with us.
Yes, I'm so grateful to you coming up tonight and bringing the ears and the love and the
thank you for inviting me.
Gusto,
yeah. Sticking with me till we finally got it. Till we finally got it in, right?
We were talking about this for a while.
Yeah.
All right. Let's go. We got some more. We got more. More Wes.
Hey.
Back to the half note. February 19th, 1965. Wynton Kelly. I wish Wynton and Larry Ridley on bass and Jimmy Cobb were maybe a little higher in the mix, but I'm glad we got plenty of Wes in there.
Yeah. You know, something else that I'm always coming up with these little anecdotes, but there's this notion that jazz was something that's always played soft, and that the older cats played soft, and it was, you know, Wes played very loud.
Oh really?
Oh yeah, he played loud.
Wow.
And I remember, and I'm not going to say it's like loud for the. I don't know that when I say loud that people, but it certainly wasn't like quiet. You know, a cafe, a corner street, the coffee shop. Wes played. He played with force and volume. You know, I got a taste. You know, my perspective on volume in jazz is different because as the as a youngster, you know, like in, back in 87, I joined Jack McDuff's band. And those organ players would come into a small club and have that sucker on fire, right?
So, yeah, yeah.
And so
we're talking big-time Hammond B3 organ.
At the same time, thanks to Donald Harrison and the late, great Walter Davis, piano player, I got to play with Art Blakey somewhere as a youngster. And Art played just as strong and just as loud. There was no tiptoeing around. Let's hear a pin drop. You can hear a pin drop through all this. You got bionic ears. You know, yeah. It's not about volume for volume's sake. It was about strength and stature on your instrument, and you know, having a certain amount of weight on your sound and presence. And it's not about. It wasn't about preserving the integrity of the acoustics. It was about filling up the room with sound and letting everybody can feel the pulse. You know. And I'm not saying I'm an advocate for any one style of playing in that way. It's just interesting when you talk about, well, you wish you could have heard them more. Yeah, I bet you do. But Wes had that sucker lit up, you know, and that's important. Because I remember when I used to play at Bradley, sometimes George Benson would come and sit in and he'd play, and he'd turn that guitar up and crank it up, and nobody said a thing about it. Nobody complained. It wasn't just because it was George's famous, because it was great.
Yeah.
Right? It wasn't loud and obnoxious. It was loud and ridiculously killing. And that's what we're going for.
Well, the sound, if you listen just to the tone, the way Wes plays, it's not a muted kind of, you know, trinkle-tinkle kind of sound. You can hear the resonance.
Oh, yeah.
Of those strings, and you've got to
pulling the sound out of the instrument for sure. He's manhandling it for sure.
All right, you're going to hear it right now. Yep. It's so we are at the Half Note downtown. These are, for my money, this is a musician's playing for themselves and the people who are fortunate enough to be in the audience.
Playing for fun, playing for all the right reasons.
All the right reasons. That's what we do. Deep Focus. I'm Mitch Goldman. So happy to have Mark Whitfield here with me.
Hey.
Hey, yeah. Back to the Half Note. WKCR.
All we possibly can. The playing theme.
Hold on, let's get this right. Is that? Oh, we did have it.
Okay. The playing theme.
Blues.
Little blues. All right. Have been the beautiful sounds of jazz here on Portraits and Jazz, live from the Half Note, presenting Wynton Kelly with the trio and the fabulous Wes Montgomery. And everyone here is enjoying themselves. We'd love for many of our listeners to come by here on a Friday night and, of course, join us here at WABC-FM. I'll be back tomorrow afternoon with our jazz matinee show from 3 until 6. Part of the cost of this stereo remote broadcast is defrayed by the Half Note Club, remote engineering by Sid Simon, Dick Sisk, and Ron Sisk. This is Alan Grant. Until tomorrow at 3, Stay beautiful.
Thank you. That's a tune called...
That chordal passage was insane. You know what I'm talking about?
Oh my God!
Jesus!
are you listeners at home? I hope you're not driving and have your head rolling around on the floor.
I would have hit somebody. Holy cow! That's crazy. Yeah.
So I mean, go out and get smoking at the half note. Sure. You know what happened? In the last couple of years, the ORTF. Live recordings in Paris from right around this time was released, and another one in, I'm trying to remember if it was in Netherlands or Denmark, another European live performance. They're brilliant, but they don't sound like this.
Not like this, no. But even the ones that have Johnny Griffin on it, a lot of it, too, is it's not this rhythm section.
Right.
Yeah, it's a great rhythm section. It's Jimmy Lovelace and Harold Mayburn.
Yes,
and Chilin,
yes,
but,
yes.
But, yeah, it's not... Arthur Harper on bass.
Yes,
But it ain't Wynton Kelly and Jimmy Cobb and Ron Carter or Arthur, Larry Ridley or even Paul Chambers.
It's New York City nightlife 1965. Yeah. I mean,
come on. Cream of the crop. Exactly.
Wow.
Well, so go get any of that Wes Montgomery from that. Oh, God. That was so killing, though. Jesus.
Well, we're coming to the end of three glorious hours of it, and Mark Whitfield's been my guest for all of it. I'm so grateful to you for coming through.
I can't thank you enough, one, for inviting me, and two, for being patient enough we finally got it together. The other thing is, I really was coming up here going, what else am I going to say about Wes? I've been talking about Wes for 30 years. Like, I'm just, I literally have had my mind blown.
Yeah.
Even without the Wes in the hotel room thing, like even without that, just, our eye opening, sort of eye opening conversations and passing information back and forth about Wes, hearing him go for complete broke, just going for broke on these, I'm on a cloud nine and on fire. All I can say is this Thursday night, people are going to get a full compliment of a fully loaded.
Yeah, the Django.
I'm coming at him, baby.
The Django's right around the corner from where the half note was.
Yeah, not far, exactly. Just on the block, right?
There might be some little juju coming up out of the street.
You, they're going to get something this week, man. Jesus. All right.
Well, if you missed any of it, you got another chance to get it in about a week's time. Well, what you want to do is subscribe now to the podcast, Deep Focus podcast. Oh, we got an Instagram account, too. It's at deep_focus_podcast. So it's Deep Focus Podcast, deep_focus_podcast.
Oh, okay.
And I always put up little teasers when the show's coming up, photos of the artists, little stories about it and stuff. And but you want to subscribe at in your favorite podcasting app or at the hosting site, which is mitchgoldman.podbean.com.
And the good news is, people, if you just put in deep_ then focus, the rest of it comes up. Because I definitely was like, deep_focus_podcast. But as soon as you write deep_, it comes up. It's
cool. Cool.
I'm following now.
Woo. Yeah, so this is all going to come up. You can listen to it, share it, trade with your friends.
Yes, indeed.
All that good stuff.
Amen.
There's supposed to be somebody else coming on the air, but we're going to just clobber the folks with a little bonus Wes Montgomery music.
Let them swing out with Wes. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in. Please keep listening to Mitch. What you're doing here is a great thing, man. I love you, and I'm so glad to see you, and I will continue listening and supporting.
We've got to think about who we're going to do on the next one.
Again. Oh, yeah, yeah, oh, yeah. I got some ideas.
Yes, I bet you do. All right, back to the half note. Here
Beautiful.
We go.
All right.
Alan Grant, tell us what we got coming up. It's WKCR-FM New York, WKCR-HD, WKCR.org, 89.9 FM. And hand it back over to Mr. Grant.
Wes Montgomery is featured with the Wynton Kelly Trio, with Wynton Kelly at the piano, Jimmy Cobb on drums, and Larry Ridley is sitting in for Paul Chambers on bass. Just want to remind you, this group will be here for another week, and I would suggest you come by and visit. After that, we'll have the pleasure of presenting here at the Half Note Clark Terry and Bob Rittmeyer with the quintet. Also want to remind you all to stay tuned, of course. I say tuned, but what I'm talking about is be with us tomorrow afternoon for our jazz matinee show from 3 until 6. And then the sounds of the big bands, which is also jazz orientated, from 10 until midnight here at WABC-FM. Yeah, the beautiful sounds of jazz, live and stereo. Another thing, which I wanted to make mention of, we'll have an artist with us, one of our great jazz artists, Lucky Thompson, who will be with us as our guest. We'll interview him and talk about a good number of things and play some of the new releases that he has out currently. Lucky Thompson with us tomorrow afternoon. So actually until 3, stay beautiful.